Demolition, and there's that right hand. They're hooking it up. Mount Rushmore right hand. Takayama.
Green trunks for the Southpaw. The notorious Conor McGregor. Black trunks for the champion. Jose Aldo Jr.
Conor relaxed, smiling.
Oh! Nate Diaz, he just shook up the world.
I'm not surprised.
Thanks for joining me and welcome to this week's episode of Chingazos Combat Crew. I hope you all are ready to start talking Chingazos. I got fight cancellations, fight announcements, all kinds of stuff coming up on the horizon, some jiu-jitsu talk, and some awesome fan and actually fighter made videos. You guys ready to jump into this? Let's talk Chingazos, y'all. Hope your week is kicking off to a great start. Let's get this Monday going here and check this out. You guys know Uncle Dana loves him some John Jones. And now I don't know who did this video, but I'm sure glad you did. And I'm sure Uncle Dana appreciates this. Check this out. There's been a John Jones sighting at UFC Noche. Dana White.
Holy shit. And he's the pound for pound best fighter in the world. His brothers,
wow.
Pound for pound number one, man. Don't you guys forget it. Uncle Dana knows it. Now you all know it. John Jones, not only is he number one pound for pound, but he's also a dancer. All right. Check this video out, made by none other than the one, the only Angie Overkill. If you're not a follower, hit her up on the gram. But check this out. When you're running from the cops and you hear suspect in their mid to late 20s, this is hilarious. That's an athletic build. Possibly a UFC fighter. Maybe Neil Magny. Psych. That might have been a little too loud for you guys, man. I hope not. But yeah, if you're not watching this, head over to our YouTube page at Chingazos Crew. Angie Overkill just dropped a bomb of a comedy skit here. Check it out. I'll hit you guys up with the link in the description. Let's keep the show moving, man. I'm an old school MMA junkie and a fighter that we used to love to watch back in the day, back in Pride, UFC, Glory, K1. Actually, I don't even know if he fought in Glory, but I know he did some K1 and he did a little bit of the juice. And check out the phases, the many, many phases of our boy, Alexander Uberine. 2000, 2007, yes. Back in the day, he used to fight at light heavyweight and he looked like a middleweight almost. Fast forward 2010, 2011, this is what we all call the Uberine era. This is when he was juiced to the gills. This was when he gave Brock Lesnar that knee to his guts and caused him to spit out half of his colon, I'm pretty sure. Then Econorine started to downsize little by little. 2012, 2021, but he was still in it. He was a menace. If you guys remember, he fought Francis Ngannou, did get knocked the F out, but he was in there. And then we had Overeem, who did fight in Glory. I'm sorry. There it is on the screen. 2021 to through 2022. And that brings us to present day Alexander Overeem. And now he goes by Alexander Vegetarian, because he's a little smaller now. So again, if you're listening, head over to the YouTube page so you can see the progressions of Alistair Overeem. This is a sight to behold. He is a scientific specimen, but was made in the lab, I guess. All right, speaking of made in the lab, our boy Alex Poatan Pereira has been making the rounds on the socials, and he is picking a fight with the middleweight Dricus du Plessis, the champ. Sounds like he wants to drop down in weight and face Dricus du Plessis. So this was Alexander Overeem at UFC Noche, where he was asked about fighting Dricus.
I don't know if you were trolling or not. If you could either fight Dricus du Plessis at 185 or John Jones at heavyweight, who would you fight?
Quem nunca dá uma resposta clara, aí todo mundo sabe que tá com medo.
Dricus definitely a easier fight than fighting John Jones. I think making weight would be harder than that fight. I did stop making that weight class because I say my body needed a break 2-3 fights without having to do that cut. Now I think I rested long enough. I think I can definitely do that cut and make the fight happen, but depends on him. I showed the interest many times, but he never replied.
Rodrigo Duplessis, ele dá sempre uma resposta tipo brincando, entendeu? A gente tá vendo que ele não quer. Ele tem que chegar, entendeu? E falar assim, ei, UFC. Mas a resposta que ele dá, a gente tá vendo que ele tá com medo. Cu de cachorro.
The way that he presents himself is always jokes on his response. Like he said that stuff for Strickland, for example, him. He's never serious. He's always trolling somehow when the subject's presented to him. He never takes serious. So it shows that he's scared. You know what I mean? So like, instead of him just say, look, UFC, let's make me and Pereira fight. So, clown.
So he's calling Dricus a clown, saying he doesn't want to fight him. But at the same time, check this out. UFC is planning on holding a UFC in South Africa by March 2025. So could they be setting something up with DDP in South Africa? And who is it going to be? Who is it going to be? Keeping it moving. Here we go. Check this out. So last week we had UFC Noche. We had the bantamweight strap change hands from Sean O'Malley to Merab Dvalishvili. Sean, as you guys haven't heard, said he was fighting with a torn labrum. So now he's going to be out for a while. Sounds like he's going to take some time off, get surgery, get healed up. At the same time, Rob is answering questions about what happened at the beginning of the fight. Why was he yelling at the corner? What was Herb Dean telling him? Sounds like Sean's corner was up to their old shenanigans. Again, you guys remember when they fought Aljamain Sterling? Tim Welch was yelling some things, possibly trying to distract Aljo and make him shoot early. Well, I guess he was trying to do the same thing to Merab, and Merab was not having it because he started yelling at Tim Welch, ignoring Herb Dean's warnings for a while there until Herb Dean stepped in and put a stop to both of it. So if you guys don't know, Herb gave a warning to Merab. Herb gave a warning to Tim, told Tim if he continued to do it, that he was going to remove him from the cage. So, yeah. All right, y'all. Now that Sean is out and does not have the belt anymore, all kinds of people are lining up to call him out. So there's a line of 135ers waiting for him. So now that he's taken the L again, he's got Corey Sandhagen, Piotr Jan, and Henry Cejudo. I got to be honest, man. Of these three, I think I would love to see the Corey Sandhagen, just because it's such a good matchup. They both match up stylistically. We'd get to see some awesome striking. But truly, I would love to see them run it back with Piotr Jan, because I think that they stole that one from Jan and he owes it to him. But there is some beef between Henry and Sugar, and I think that that might be something that would not only be entertaining in the cage, but the lead up to it would be amazing. There would be some awesome smack talking for sure. You know, they'd be lighting it up, man. If you guys don't know, Sean went on Henry and Kamaru Usman's podcast and totally dissed Henry Cejudo and just pulled the Dana White, got up and walked off the show. So there's a little bit of drama there. There is a little bit of drama. And I already hinted on this, but just run it back for you guys here. Sean O'Malley to undergo hip surgery following UFC 306 title loss to Merab. So hip surgery, man, that's pretty extreme. I'm wondering what kind of pain he was in. That, you know, that definitely had an effect on the fight. Now we all can understand why he looked so flat, why he wasn't bouncing around, why he wasn't doing the fadeaway jumper stuff, all that in between, you know. But shout out to Sean, man. You're fighting with the torn labrum. You're going to get surgery on your hip, and you still went 5 rounds with Merab, bro. Hey, I don't know if they need to run it back, but I would love to see a 100% Sugar back in the cage and work his way back up. And then whoever has the belt, if he's ready to challenge them, line it up, bro. Line it up. Because Sean's proved he's, I mean, I'm always hating on him. I wasn't impressed with him up until a while ago. But, hey, he's a G, man. He is a striker among strikers. And I cannot wait to see him bounce back from this. I know this is going to light a fire in him, and he's going to definitely work his way back up to the top. So as I said, he was going to be taking a break. As of lately, he has been pretty active. This was his second fight in 2024, fighting Marab and Marlon. So he did defend the belt one time. So that does make him a champ. Before that, he fought once in 2023 against Aljo, where he took the belt. Then he fought twice in 2022 against Jan and Pedro Munoz. And then before that, he fought three times in 2021 against some cans. Whatever. So as of lately, he has been fighting stiffer competition, harder opponents. So yeah, on top of that, you do have that major surgery coming your way, bro. So get that taken care of, healed up, start training, get back on the mats, bro. Can't wait to see what you're going to do. All right, man. We did have UFC Noche last week. It was a $79.95 pay-per-view. And Uncle Dana, you know he's counting all those pennies. You know he's counting each and every single pay-per-view subscription or subscriber, whatever you want to call it. But check out what he had to say. We have hacked the face cams of people who stream pay-per-view illegally, and their faces will be displayed on the sphere soon. Fonzo, you better turn your camera off, bro, because they got you. They got you on the toilet watching the Alexa Grasso fight with your shoes and off and your pants hanging on the shower curtain, bro. Turn your camera off. How many times I got to tell you, Fonzo? Be careful, guys. Don't be illegally streaming UFC on your phone. All right, man. Let's get back into fights here. We had a banger of a fight announced a while ago. Masvidal Ivolov was supposed to be taking on Aljamain Sterling at 145. It ain't going to happen. I'm not sure what the injury was, but Aljamain Sterling sustained an injury, so he's going to have to take a step back. And unfortunately, I don't think that they're planning on waiting and rescheduling this bout, because a lot of other people are chomping at the bit to try to get at Masvidal, including the man on the screen right here, John Silver from MMA Nerds. Masvidal Ivolov responds, a lot of people say they want to fight me on the internet, but you really want to fight me, call the UFC. I'll fight you, make 145, and it's a go. I know you're more dangerous than Sterling, but I want to be champion. I have to beat everyone. So there it is. John the Lord Silva says, let's go. I think that's an awesome fight, but what I don't like is that there's only a few weeks before that fight is supposed to go down. And I would love to see this guy with a full camp, even though that's what he does, man. John Silva's always taking on fights in short notice, and he beats the dog shit out of everybody. But I know that he had a hard time making 145 the last time around. So I don't know if they could do a catch weight. I would hate for him to get this fight, then not make weight, then Masvidal pulls some BS where he's like, hey, I'm not going to fight. You know what I mean? But check out Diego Lopes. Diego Lopes chiming in too. Brother, since my first victory in the UFC, I called you to fight. You could make excuses that you were above me in the rankings. Since our fight, I have 5 victories. While you only fought once, you were lower in the rankings, not to mention that you have not finished anyone. And then Masvidal responds, hey, Ige almost beat you a couple months ago. Why are you lying saying you called me out? Next time I see you, maybe I give you a proper haircut because your barber is very bro. That is some weak shit talking, man. Tell him you want to fight. Tell the UFC to reschedule this. Diego has leaped you in the rankings, my man. You're not even in the top 5. So, speaking of our boy Diego Lopes, after he put that beat down on Brian Ortega last week, he jumped up 10 spots from number 13 all the way up to number 3, took Brian's number 3 spot. And now the only two people above him, I'm sorry, 3 people above him, is Max Holloway, Alexander Volkanovski, and Ilia Topuria. So Ilya's already fighting Max. That only leaves Volkanovski. So does that mean we're going to see a Volk and Diego Lopes fight at the end of the year? That would be a really good fight. I don't know if that's good for Volk, but that would be a hell of a test for Diego. And if he can survive that, like he's been surviving all his other fights, bro, give him a title shot. Give him the title shot, bro. He is ready for it. All right, guys. So here's Diego again chiming back after Masvidal said, hey, you got 2.5 weeks to fight me. Ask the UFC if you can fight. Bro, you had your chance a few months ago when I called you to fight. Now you sit back and watch the bus leave. watch as the bus leaves you waiting. I'm sorry. So yeah, Diego with the mic drop there telling Mazdar, bro, shut up. I called you out months ago. You didn't want to fight. Now you see me at number three. I fought five times while you've only fought once. Now you want to fight? Oh, now you want to play. Come on, bro. Come on. Mazdar, who?
Who the fuck is that guy?
Right, guys?
Exactly. Who? Mazdar, who, bro? Let's keep this show going. Fight announcements for my birthday. It's going down December 7th, Pearl Harbor Day. Virna Jandiroba versus Tatiana Suarez. This is going to be a strawweight eliminator fight. This is going to be good because you know it's going to go to the ground. And both of these ladies, they are both amazing grapplers, but they both do it a different way, where Tatiana uses her wrestling and jiu-jitsu versus Verna's just straight up buzzsaw jiu-jitsu. So stay tuned to that December 7th. Hopefully these two ladies can stay healthy. Tatiana, I'm looking at you, girl. We would love to see this fight. All right. Sticking with the December theme, our boy Islam Makhachev says that he is going to be ready to fight by the end of the year or the beginning of January. Let's go, guys. Let's go. That's going to be badass. So this is what he says. I have a small injury now, but I'm already finishing my treatment. I'll be ready around the end of the year. January, beginning of the year. So he's saying January. I don't know where they're getting December from. But Armand, stay ready, bro. It's going to happen very, very soon. All right. Here we go. A little jiu-jitsu talk. We just wrapped up CJI a couple months ago. We had ADCC. Now the tournaments are going to keep on flowing. We got IBJJF Nogi Worlds coming up at the end of the year. But before that, going down October 10th, UFC Fight Pass Invitational 8, El Ocho, going down. Check out this main event. Nicky Rod taking on Michael Pixley. So CJI million-dollar winner Nicky Rod going to be taking on up-and-coming Jiu-Jitsu Michael Pixley, who I believe is only a blue belt, possibly. I don't think he's a purple belt. But if you don't know who he is, he's the guy who manhandled Nicholas Mirigali. I know Mirigali got injured in the fight, but it was because this dude was making him work so much. So this should be a pretty good match while it lasts. I expect Nicky Rod to easily manhandle Michael Pixley, but we should see some really, really good wrestling there, man. And then check this out. I don't know if this is co-main or this is just a matchup that's going to be announced there, but Renato Canuto taking on PJ Barch. If you like scrambles, you like takedowns, you like quick, fast action, no-gi jiu-jitsu, that is the match you're going to want to watch. They're here for a good time, not a long time, man. That's going to be a fun, fun scrap to watch. So stay tuned. October 10th. We're like 3 weeks away from that. All right. Sticking with the jiu-jitsu theme, you know I'm always searching Reddit, scouring the globe for interesting things to read. I thought this was a cool little read here. So this looks like a little bingo board, but every day for the last few weeks on a subreddit of the subreddit of BJJ on Reddit, people have been voting on these specific jiu-jitsu categories. Most underrated jiu-jitsu, most overrated, the best coach, the worst coach, the funniest coach, the most annoying, the most potential, the most wasted potential, the most hype to watch, the most boring jiu-jitsu to watch, the best teacher, the worst teacher. So those are the categories that have already been announced, yet they still have four more. One tournament wonder, most aggressive, best skills, and fight IQ. So what we have here for everybody listening and not watching on our YouTube page, everyone voted Bernardo Faria as the most underrated jiu-jitsu. And of course, he says, huge honor, right? Most overrated jiu-jitsu, Nicky Ryan. Yikes. Best jiu-jitsu, Marcelo Garcia. I also believe Hodger Gracie was close second there. Worst jiu-jitsu besides me, Orlando Sanchez. Yikes. Funniest jiu-jitsu, Craig Jones. Most annoying jiu-jitsu, Henner Gracie. Most potential in a jiu-jitsu, most potential jiu-jitsu, Joseph Chen. Most wasted potential, most wasted BJJ potential, Dylan Donis. Most hyped to watch, Mika Galvao. Most boring to watch, Yuri Samoz. Best teacher, Lachlan Giles. Worst teacher, Seth Daniels. Fight to win. Shots fired.
What the fuck?
Yikes. All right. So I'll have the rest of this when they fill out the entire card on next week's show. But this is pretty good, man. This was pretty, pretty good. Speaking of jujitsu and not good, this is the opposite. IBJJF came out with this hot new way of being able to take your money. Introducing the IBJJF Gi Checker Tool, now available at IBJJF. Get yours for $59.99 plus shipping and handling. Just kidding. I don't know how much it costs, but that thing is freaking worthless. Now you can have a tool to check the sleeves of your gi, check the collars, make sure it's up to date, make sure it fits those IBJJF specs. Whatever, man. Check this out. I love the comments on Reddit. They already turned the comments off on this one. Cowards die many times before their deaths. Just like Nicholas Mirigali, they turned the comments off. This was a crock of shit, man. This is why people don't sign up for IBJJF tournaments, man. Let's switch gears here. Let's talk UFC. So check this out, man. Here's some cheesement for you guys, some drama. Figgy, Davison Figueiredo, apparently turned down a fight against number one contender Corey Sanhagen, according to Corey Sanhagen on his YouTube channel. Now, I don't have the timeline for this. I don't know if this was before he fought Umar. I don't know if this was a proposed to both of these guys after he lost to Umar. I think this would be a great fight. This could have been before Corey lost to Umar, a number one contender fight here. You know, the winner here gets the next shot. But as you guys already know, Umar beat Corey. Now Corey's looking to make his way back up to the top. And this would be great for both of them. This would be a little more dangerous for Figgy, as I think he's done enough to fight for the strap. But hey, another fight against another top contender. If you get the W, bro, you're just cementing your name at the top. So why not? All right, next story. So we were supposed to be seeing Ciryl Gane taking on Alexander Volkov at UFC 308. It has been canceled and has been rescheduled for UFC 310 down the line in December. I'm not sure what the extent of the injury is. All I know is that Volkov sustained some type of injury and he is not going to be able to make the UFC 308 bout that he was originally scheduled to fight for. So now they're pushing it a couple months down the line. I'm all for this, man. And I'm with Fonzo on this one. I think Volkov is going to beat the brakes off of Ciryl Gane just because he's been more active and he's been on a rise, man. I think he's more of a grinder than Ciryl Gane. So going to be a good fight. So we'll see what happens. All right. We had a little boxing last night. Wembley Stadium. Anthony Joshua taking on Daniel Dubois for some kind of belt, man. These big boys were going at it and it did not take long. Check this out. All right, last night we had a little bit of boxing going down. Wembley Stadium, Anthony Joshua taking on Daniel Dubois, and it did not take very long for these monsters to get at it. Check this out. This is round five, and up. And dude, I want to say Daniel Dubois was dropping Anthony Joshua from the get-go. He was putting a major beatdown on him from round one on. I cannot believe he made it this far, but check this out. Round five. About 30 seconds into round five, Anthony Joshua is backing up Danny, but watch what Danny's got for you, bro. Look at this right hand. Bap, bap, doop. Gosh, I have never seen anybody do this to this man ever. What a crazy year of boxing we've had, man. We've had every champ go down. Tyson Fury, Anthony Joshua. Bro, they just keep on dropping, man. This is crazy. Alexander Usyk's the champ now. Man, we got all kinds of good stuff happening. So, hey, boxing is great again. Thank you, Riyadh Season, for this. And we had another banger of a fight. So if you get a chance to go and watch this, man, go and rewatch this fight because this is what heavyweight boxing is all about right here, man. These guys are just dropping bombs. All right, guys. I got UFC 308 full card on the screen from top to bottom. Check this out. Main card, main event, Ilia Topuria, Max Holloway, Bobby Knuckles taking on Khamzat Chimaev, Ciryl Gane, and Alexander Volkov. We just said that's going to be moved. So I'm wondering if they're going to replace that fight at all, or they're just probably going to move something up from the prelims up. Ankalaev taking on Alexander Rakic, Magomedov taking on Armand Petrosian, Leon Murphy taking on Dan Ige. That's going to be a banger right there, man. All right, let's look at these prelims here. Check that out. Leon Murphy, Dan Ige, Neil versus RDA, Robecki versus Olave. That is going to be a caveman fight, and all kinds of other good stuff on this card. So I cannot wait. Lots of good stuff on the main card, and we got a lot of good stuff on the prelims too. So as we get closer to November, I'm going to start breaking these fights down for y'all. So that way we can make a little bit of money, or at least we know what to talk about come fight day. So next weekend, guys, we got UFC Fight Night, main event, Renato Money Moicano taking on Benoit Saint-Denis. The main event and co-main event of this card are going to be amazing. It's going to be on ESPN+. Go get yourself a subscription. This could be a nice little card to watch. Main event, again, Money Moicano taking on Benoit Saint-Denis. Money Moicano is a underdog at plus 186. Benoit Saint-Denis minus 245. And then the co-main event, Nasruddin Imavov, a minus 250 favorite. And Brandon Allen, a plus 190. Remember, Brandon Allen took on Chris Curtis last time. Didn't look too hot, so I could see why that number's there. Money Moicano, you never know what you're going to get with that guy. And you guys remember Benoit Saint-Denis got buzzsawed by Dustin Poirier last time, but he looked good in the first round. And he was going into that fight with a little staph infection, it looked like. Maybe a little cigarette burn, remember there? But I would imagine this is going to be a beatdown. He's going to be fighting in front of his hometown crowd. So Renato is going into enemy territory. And I think he's going to catch a beatdown, man. All right, y'all. That is it. That's all I got for you. Thank you so much for joining me. I hope you guys have a fantastic week. We got lots of fights to talk about next week. Join me and the crew here. Until next week, have a fantastic week, y'all. Chingazos crew out. Peace.
I'm not surprised.